No, excuse me, sir. We'll allow questions only from the mic. And in turn, please, we have to keep the decorum and the people who have stood for some time. The next question, please.
My name is Roshan Rangwala, a businessman. Question is, Roknai, as you said that Islam gives equal right to both ladies and gents, then why men is allowed to keep four wives and ladies are kept away from this privilege? As men can think of another woman, at the same time, after marrying one wife, men can think for another woman, why ladies cannot think for another?
The brother asked the question that since Islam allows polygyny, why does not Islam allow polyandry? A man is allowed to marry more than one wife. Why isn't a woman allowed to marry more than one husband? Firstly, you should realize that man is more sexual than the woman. Point number two, biologically, a man can perform his duty as a husband even after he has more than one wife, which a woman, if she has more than one husband, she will not be able to perform her duties as a wife enough and satisfactorily. Medical science tells us that the lady during a menstrual period undergoes certain behavioral and psychological changes in which she is mentally disturbed, and therefore the majority of the quarrels that take place during the menstrual period. According to a report of the criminal record of the woman in USA, most of the ladies that committed the crime was during the menstrual period. Therefore, for a wife, if she has more than one husband, to mentally adjust will be more difficult. Medical science also tells us that if a lady has more than one husband, she has chances of acquiring sexually transmitted diseases as well as venereal diseases, and she can transmit it back to the husband, which is not the case if a husband has more than one wife. And suppose a man who has more than one wife, if he marries and if he has children, the identification of both the parents is possible. The father can be identified as well as the mother can be identified. In the other case, if a wife has more than one husband, you will only identify the mother, not the father. Islam gives utmost importance to identification of the parents. And psychologists tell us that if a child cannot identify his parent, he undergoes mental trauma. No wonder the children of prostitute, they have a very bad childhood. And if that child goes for admission in the school, and if he's asked, what's the name of your father? You'll have to give two names. And you know what such a child is called. There are several reasons why polyandry is not allowed. And for counter-argument, if you tell me that I gave you several reasons why polygyny is allowed. For example, if a couple does not have issue, and if they marry, a man is allowed to take more than one wife. If suppose the husband is sterile, can the wife take more than one husband? No. Because no doctor can give you the guarantee that the husband is 100% sterile. Even if you do vasectomy, even if you do nasbandi, no doctor can tell you that the child cannot be a father. So still, again, the identification of the child is yet in doubt. In the other case, suppose the husband, he undergoes an accident or he becomes very severely ill. Can't the wife take care of the husband? Let's analyze. Suppose the husband, if he undergoes an accident or if he's severely ill, he cannot perform his duty very well. Firstly, on the financial aspects, he will not be able to look after the family, the children and the wife. And secondly, he may not be able to satisfy the wife. Regarding the first criteria, where you cannot satisfy the children and the wife, Islam has an option. Islam allows such people to take zakat. Those people who can't make both their ends meet, they can take zakat. And the second aspect, medical science tells us that a wife requires less conditions to be satisfied as compared to a husband. But still, if the wife still wants to, still if she's not satisfied, she has all the reasons to take kula from the husband and marry another husband. Here, a wife taking kula is much more preferred, because here when the wife is getting divorced, she is healthy. In the other case, if she's disabled, if she's handicapped, if she is divorced, who will marry her? Hope that answers the question.
I'm Shahzadi Hakim. I would like to ask questions. The first thing is, here you have a subject, women's rights in Islam. There, I think more women should have asked more questions, and it could have been better. Rights and duties of men, that subject would have been better. But the question is, you said in your speech, it was very lucid and nice, that a girl can say no if she doesn't want to marry a particular person. But while speaking in your lecture, you have said that a woman cannot be economically independent, in the sense she cannot earn. And can these people, when a girl says no, look after the child, say nicely, she is always going to be under the mercy of the male folk under these circumstances? I would like to know what is the answer.
Excuse me, can you put your question in just two or three, what answer you want? We would request all the questioners, you present your question, the basic background of problems in society. I believe Dr. Zakir would be having an idea about it. You kindly state your question. What is the question?
My question is that he said that a girl can say no if she doesn't want to marry a particular person. But the male folk are feeding her, looking after her. She is dependent on them. Can she exist safely after saying no?
Sister, that's the question that I said in my lecture, that a woman has a right to say no for marriage. But will she be able to safely exist after saying no? You didn't pay attention to my full lecture, sister. In my lecture, I said, it's the duty of the man in the family. Before marriage, it's the duty of the father and the brother to look after her lodging, clothing, boarding, and financial aspects. And after marriage, it's the duty of the husband and the son to look after financial aspects. So if she says no, yet it continues to be the duty of the father and the brother to look after her. She can very well say no. I don't know what's the problem.
The next question, please.
I'm Prakash Bhute. First of all, I will thank organizers for calling people of all faiths. And so I'm asking another question. For all the religions, whether it is Hinduism, Christian or Islam, in books there are many good things. But for years, after thousands of years, the practices of all the religion have been discriminatory towards women. And no religion is an exception to this. So the question is, what is written in the books, whether it is Bible, Quran or Gita or whatever it is, whether that is more important or the practice of the society which is more important? And if practice is more important, then we should give very little importance to what is being written in all such holy books, including Quran, Gita, whatever it is. So on this, I'll expect answer where in practice what could be done instead of saying what is being written in this book or that book.
Thank you.
The brother asked a very good question. He says that all the scriptures speak about good things, but let's see what people practice. We have to pay more importance to the practice than the theoretical things. And I do agree with him. What we are doing here is that, I have said in my lecture, that many Muslim societies have deviated away from the Quran and the Sunnah. What we are doing here is we are calling the people to come closer to the Quran and Sunnah. And regarding your first part of the question, that all religious scriptures speak good. So it's useless talking about religious scriptures. I don't agree with you. I have given a lecture on status of women in Islam and other religion. And I've compared the status of women in Islam as compared to Hinduism,